Hello, hello, good evening, and welcome to another special installment of Book Passages Conversations with Authors. If you haven't already done it, just take a second and definitely subscribe to our YouTube channel. It's something that's very quick and easy for you, but it means so much to Book Passage. Thank you for joining us and supporting a local independent bookstore. And thanks in advance for supporting today's authors by actually buying their books. and we love it when you buy it from Book Passage. You can give us a call or order online, or feel free to come into the stores safely in San Francisco and Corte Madera and get the book. In today's featured book, we do have book plates. So we have signed first editions for you. And I'm especially happy. This is one of our first events with the new year, and I think it's such a special event. And these are both fantastic authors with really stunning collection of books between the two of them. Starting with our featured author, Jean Chen Ho, and her debut of collections, Fiona and Jane, which is such a delight in so many ways. Great characters with a lot of wit and heart. It's sure to be one of my favorites of 2022. I know I'm saying this really early, but I'm going out on a limb here, and I think it's going to make the list. And I think you'll love it too. It's witty, warm, edgy. The traces story about the traces of lives of two young Taiwanese American women as they navigate their friendship, sexuality, identity, heartbreak, and kind of navigate their teen years, and with the backdrop of Los Angeles, and also kind of navigating family dynamics. So it's very interesting. Jean is a doctoral candidate in creative writing and literature at the University of Southern Cal. She has an MFA from the University of Nevada. Her writing has been published in the Georgia Review, GQ, Harper's Bazaar, and that's just naming a very few publications. She was born in Taiwan, grew up in Southern Cal, and lives in Los Angeles. In conversation with Jean is a Bay Area favorite of mine, Vanessa Wah. Not only is she a kind and generous person, she's very talented and an interesting writer who has a special place in my heart because she was one of the very first panelists for my special Race in America panel events for Book Passage. So I've always appreciated that she was one of the first. More importantly though, Vanessa is an award-winning columnist for the San Francisco Chronicle. Her novel, A River of Stars, was named to the Washington Post Notable Works of Fiction. And her next novel is due out in April. I believe the title is Forbidden City, and I believe that is an April pub date. Please welcome to our virtual stage, Jean and Vanessa.
Thank you so much for that wonderful introduction, Paula. Jean, I'm so excited to be in conversation with you tonight, and I have so many questions, and we'll get them from the audience too. But I was thinking, so we met in person at the Toon House Writers Workshop, and I had a really amazing opportunity to see an earlier version of your story, Go Slow. And I loved it. And I think we're going to be reading from it tonight.
Yeah. So thank you. Also, thank you, Paula, for that amazing introduction. Vanessa, I'm so excited to be here. Shout out to Tin House for introducing us in real life. And I have to say, like, special shout out to the winter workshop at Tin House, because that hotel that we stayed in was like so beautifully, like each room was themed by an author. And there was a cat in the hotel. It was just an amazing experience.
And a ghost, apparently.
I chose to ignore that part of the weekend, but you know, that's neither here or there. But I'm excited to read the published version of the story that I shared with Vanessa's workshop back in winter of 2019. So this is, I'm going to read from the first section of the story that's titled Go Slow. The year we turned 16, Fiona decided it was time we learned to drink. We drove to the Norwalk swap meet and laid out $50 each for fake IDs from a passport photo, faxing, and color copy stall. A Gujarati family owned the business, and the girl we paid off had graduated from our high school a few years back. When she handed us the finished IDs, we knew right away we'd been scammed. They were flimsy, laminated jobs, no better than Blockbuster membership cards, overexposed photos of our unsmiling faces glued onto a rectangle of white paper, with California identification card typed across the top, our names and birthdays below, minus those crucial 5 years to age us up to 21. We were too embarrassed to demand our money back. Still, we were eager to test them out. That was when we called Juan. He said he knew a place, and the three of us set out one Saturday night in Shamu, Fiona's hatchback, she named after the SeaWorld killer whale because of the corroding white patches all over the black paint. The freeway glowed with stop-and-go brake lights. We barely moved, no more than 10, 12, 15 miles an hour. 7:30 at night, the sky was a washed-out indigo, a few dirty gray wisps hanging low. No doubt Shamu was a hoopty, but she was ours. Well, she was Fiona's, which meant she was mine too. We were best friends. We shared everything. Juan leaned forward from the back seat. Lucky this place isn't card, he said. You guys are dumb if you think those janky IDs will get you anywhere. Put on your seatbelt before I get a ticket, Fiona said. Juan told her the name of the exit somewhere off the 5 in Garden Grove. He was taking us to a suju, he called it. Trust me, Juan said. It's gonna work out. Just be cool. You hear that, Jane? Shut up, I said. I could be cool. Behind there, it's that place in the corner. I looked out the windshield to where Juan was pointing. Fiona steered into the parking lot of a strip mall. She hesitated. Should I, right in front? Between a brightly lit 24-hour donut shop and a dry cleaner's with its pleated metal shutter pulled down for the night, there stood an unmarked storefront with a row of large windows, the glass tinted black. You couldn't see inside at all. A neon sign buzzed red in one of the darkened panes, something spelled out in Korean characters. I exchanged a quick glance with Fiona before we climbed out of Shamu. I could see the excitement in her eyes and that she was trying to hide it. So I'll stop there.
Thank you. I love that story. And actually, I just have been recommending it to all my students and friends. And so I was so curious with that particular story, where you wrote it in sequence of stories, or what was the first story in the collection? It is, I don't know if we've said it yet, but that the collection spans about 20 years of their friendship. So I was very curious if you wrote it, everything chronologically, or if this particular story came first, or what, just your process in that.
That's a great question. So, you know, part of writing a book is that I think, at least for me, I didn't realize that I was writing a book when I started this. So I did not write it chronologically. I didn't even know that, you know, I just started writing stories about these women. So the first story that I wrote in this collection was the one called Movers. So that's sort of near the back because they're in their early 30s at that point.
Toward the end.
Yeah. So that story, so the book is told in alternating voices. So like Go Slow that I just read from is from Jane's point of view, and all the Jane stories are in first person. And then as I was writing, all the Fiona stories are in third person, but the Movers, which is the first story, was from Jane's point of view. And it has both of the women together because some of the stories have only one or the other. And that story, after I finished that story, I sort of felt like I wanted to know more about who these women were, like just more about their families and their worlds, what they were doing before and after, because in that story, Fiona had just moved back from out of town. And, you know, I was just kind of curious about who they were. I felt like I wasn't done with them yet. And as for this story that I just read from, I don't quite remember like the order of how I wrote these stories, because you know how it's like you write one thing and then you set it aside for like 6 months and then you write another thing and then maybe you return to that other thing or you just like give up on it. So there was a lot of like back and forth. But I do remember that Go Slow was actually part of the same story as The Night Market, which is the first story in the book. So in that story is when Jane goes back to Taiwan to visit her father. And so there was just like too much going on in that story with Jane and her father. And then also like this like kind of like B story with Jane and Fiona learning how to drink and getting into trouble. And I ultimately felt like the B story just deserved its own space. So that's how this story that I just read from came about.
Yeah, and then just the ghost story, the night market story, is that the Shiling Night Market, right?
Yeah, have you been there?
Yes, totally. Well, I was going to ask you there, but I'll just ask now. Did you ever go to Love Boat or?
I did not go to Love Boat because my parents would not allow me. I mean, I'm an only child, so my parents were like very protective of me in high school, and they just would never have trusted me to go on like a thing like that by myself.
Well, and I suppose I should explain what Love Boat is.
Sure, yeah.
But basically it was a government, for those of you tuning in, it was a government program where people from the Chinese diaspora would come from around the world, but it was a big party, a big 6-week government subsidized party in the hopes that we would love the ROC versus the PRC, which we can also get into in this conversation.
And it's for like teenagers, right? Like
or for college students. There is okay. Baby boat, but then there's college students go too.
Okay.
Yeah.
But anyway, so you went to Love Boat.
Yes.
Okay. And is it true that it's like a hookup situation?
Yes, there is neither a boat. There is not a boat, but plenty of love. So we're just going to dance clubs with names like Kiss or just, you know, I don't know what the drinking age is. It didn't seem to matter, right? So, but anyway, enough about Love Boat. I think another thing I admire so much about the book is the way it so easily moves around in the diaspora, that like it's, you know, there's Chinese people everywhere. So, or Taiwanese, you know, well, that's also yet another issue of identity, but just the fact that this is just the world, there is not a sense of like ghettoization or just like people only being in one neighborhood, but just this sort of the span of their lives. And I was wondering if you could kind of talk about that, what it means to inhabit these geographies where, say, people wouldn't necessarily, some people wouldn't necessarily see these characters.
Yeah. Well, I think that this book is definitely not like an immigrant story. It's not the story of a family coming over from the home country and then trying to figure out how to live in America. So it's really about Fiona and Jane. Well, I mean, Fiona did immigrate to the US when she was a child, but Jane was born in the US. And I mean, the stories start when they're teenagers and moves into their 20s and 30s. And there is a lot of tension and conflict with their families and secrets coming out. But you know, as you're saying about the diasporic nature of these stories, I think I just wanted to write about ordinary people, like these two women who are just living their lives, sometimes getting into trouble, maybe getting into debt, falling in love, having sex, like making bad choices, without necessarily, you know, making a comment about how that's like a part of immigrant or Taiwanese American identity. You know, I was just having fun and like making horrible things happen to them, which has been like, I think, the experience of like me growing up in the US. So I don't know if that answers your question.
No, it does. It does. And I think it really subverts sort of like model minority or good immigrant tropes, right? They're just living their lives, right? And the mistakes that anyone who like is sort of like given their full humanity, right, can make. Though that said, I know you yourself were born in Taiwan and moved here as a child, and I was wondering, being bicultural, bilingual, how did that form you as a writer, do you think?
Well, I feel like at this point I'm like barely bilingual, because and I learned this term a while back, which is that you can be a receptive bilingual, which sounds like slightly sexual, but it's not. It's just that you, and this is the kind of bilingual I am, which is that I can receive the language, I could like understand what people are saying a lot better than I can produce the vocabulary or the words to like, you know, communicate. So yeah, I think I grew up speaking both Mandarin and Taiwanese, mm-hmm. Because my mom's side of the family spoke Taiwanese Hokkien, and my dad's side of the family, you know, were from the mainland who escaped to Taiwan in the late 40s. So that side only spoke Mandarin. And then, you know, when I came to the US with my parents, and so obviously my parents only spoke Mandarin to one another, because that was like the official language, right? Mm-hmm. The compulsory language. And so when I came to the US, all of my Taiwanese like totally fell off, because I'd never heard it. I didn't speak with my grandparents or my family members. And then even the Mandarin has like fallen off in a really big way, you know? So I don't know if it's affected me as a writer, because I can't, like I said, I can't produce the words. I can sort of get by at a second grade, third grade level, maybe not even that. But I think it's made me really observant, because every time I do go to Taiwan with my family, I feel like I have to listen so hard to try to understand, you know, whereas in English, it's just like you can eavesdrop anywhere easily because I'm fluent. So maybe that quality has seeped in somehow, the sort of like deep attention I'm forced to pay to even like comprehend all of what's going on.
Yeah, definitely. Although I think sometimes, or do you feel like, I feel like I'll be in a crowded market or somewhere and I'll hear Mandarin two aisles over and I don't really know, I can't pick up on everything, but it's like almost like it's in some reptilian part of my brain that I recognize it and can pick it out from the crowd immediately. I don't know if Taiwanese is like that for you. Yeah,
it is, because it's like a really familiar tune, you know, it has like certain rhythms and inflections that are very familiar and make me feel just sort of like nostalgic almost. So like when I hear my mom talking to her sisters on the phone, I don't know what the hell they're talking about, but it sort of like reminds me of my childhood in a really nice way.
Yeah, definitely. And I did say, I did love how Fiona was Ona in Taiwan, and she became Fiona, she got renamed here, and that foam is like both wind and both crazy. Yeah, and I will add one other thing. It's also Phoenix, because I knew that because it's part of my name. So.
Oh my God, that's amazing. I did not know that. I don't know. Vanessa, do you feel like a lot of immigrant kids like got their English names just from like the dictionary or like some random book, you know?
Or either they tried to pick something that sounded sort of like the Chinese name, or my parents, they picked it purely for the meaning.
Mm.
So that's why I have a sister named Inez, because it means queen of the seas, and my dad loved to sail. And Vanessa means queen of the butterflies. So how did you come to have your name, Jean?
Well, it sort of sounds like my Chinese name, but not really. So at one point, there were like a couple of choices. Like at one point they were going to just name me Jennifer, because that was just like a very popular name at that
time. In the late 70s, I think you were born after that, but in the late 70s.
Yeah. In the 80s, maybe even into the 90s. Yeah. So I almost became Jennifer. And then another one was Peace. Like one of my dad's hippie friends was like, you should name her Peace.
Right.
And then, so that was like a choice, which I think could have been kind of cool now, but I wonder if I would have been like a totally different person if my name was Peace. I don't know.
That is always a haunting question of, does your name define you? Or I certainly have Asian American friends who picked different names when they went to college. For whatever reason. And then actually some who went from that name back to their original name.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, a lot of interesting choices around that. So I caught part of the Bellatrist interview. And congratulations on being a Bellatrist book club pick.
Thank you.
And a Yes Way Rosé pick.
Oh my gosh. They came over here and I like convinced three of my friends to come and like be a part of this very fun photo shoot, like drinking rosé as a part of book promotions. And I got so drunk by the end of it. It was so ridiculous. Yeah. But yes, it is. There's like a cross promotional thing going on with Yes Way Rosé.
Yes. But I did, what was interesting part of the Bellatrist interview was that you talked about figuring out the astrology of your characters. I don't know if it was just for this book or all characters, you kind of do their chart.
I mean, astrology is just a hobby of mine. It's been like of interest to me ever since I was a teenager.
Yeah.
And if I remember correctly, you are an Aries. Am I right?
That is, and you are Gemini.
Yeah. So, I mean, I thought about when I was writing these characters, I don't know how I came up on this idea that I have to decide what. Oh, I know. It's because I'm really bad at math. And like part of writing a book, which I didn't anticipate, is that you have to do a lot of math. Like you have to figure out what ages these people are, like what year they were born, like how much time has passed. But anyway, like it was just a lot of math that I had to do to figure out, like even in the section that I just read, I had to be like, okay, if they're 16, it's -5 to get to 21. Even like that sort of stuff really threw me. But I was like, okay, I have to figure out when they're born. And I just sort of came upon the idea that I want to figure out what their birthdays are, mm-hmm. as a way to get to know their characters. So to get to know these characters. So I decided that it seemed very natural to me that Jane would be a Pisces because she's definitely more of an observer. She's sort of dreamy, intuitive. Mm-hmm. And she is very aware. She's good at like sort of reading the room and knowing what's going on. And Fiona, I made her a Virgo / Libra cusp because I felt that I have such an admiration for Virgos. They're sort of like just people who have it together and very smart and ambitious, great storytellers. And so I felt that way about Fiona, who's like this very driven young lady. So I made her a Virgo and that's what they are. I don't know. Yeah. It doesn't come out in the book. It's just, this
yeah,
is
yeah.
Just
no, like none of it's in the book, actually.
Subtext. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, but back to speaking of the year they were born, I was curious what their Chinese zodiac was.
Oh my God, Vanessa, I don't know. I just told you I can't do math.
I'm sorry. No. I actually kind of looked it up trying to guess.
Uh-huh.
Are they born in 1980 or 81, do you think?
I had figured all of this out. Like I had a huge spreadsheet and I made them sort of born somewhere in the late 70s, early 80s. So they're sort of like geriatric millennials. And then we went back and forth in the edits about whether we would put the year of the story at the top of each chapter or each section. And then we took that out. One thing that I did want to do is I wanted to end the book before 2016 because I didn't want this world to include Donald Trump as the president. So, so that's like a clue.
I had guessed that maybe they were 1980, which would make them monkeys, or 1981, which would make them roosters. If somehow this very specific question ever comes up again.
I really don't know that much about Chinese zodiac, unfortunately. So
yeah, I feel very much, I feel very much a rabbit. So I don't know if, what is your, do you know what your zodiac is?
I am a monkey. So, you know, I feel like I do look up, I looked up the definitions of like what each zodiac sign meant, but I don't know. It's just like, sort of like in the bigger picture of things. Like, are we, because we're born in the same year, are we all this way? I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, that is, I think that's sort of the difference in the zodiacs, like the context of maybe the time of year versus the year, like where, what are the parameters of your cohort, right? And how that may define you, or birth order, or all those things, right?
Are you having, let me ask you a question. Are you having a New Year's celebration, a lunar New Year, a Chinese New Year celebration in 22?
Well,
do you typically do that?
Well, in some ways, so it's February 1st this year, and in some ways, I think I became more interested in the rituals and traditions as I became an adult. In fact, my mom, because I think growing up, it was just eating, my parents were working, it was just like, order, getting Chinese food and getting the red envelopes, right?
But now, oh yeah, the red envelopes, that was everything.
Yeah. But now it's all about like cleaning the house, getting new clothes. But the thing that the pandemic has put on hold for me is you're supposed to get a haircut, which is kind of a nice light feeling, but I didn't get one for, I haven't cut my hair since 2019 in preparation for Lunar New Year, which was in January of that year. So I don't know. And now with the surge, I'm like, do I just keep not cutting my hair? So anyway, yeah, I don't want to detract from your reading though.
Okay. I was just curious.
Yeah. I will. I've been thinking about how there's just such a wonderful flourishing of Taiwanese American writers. It's already, been around, writers like Ed Lin and Esme Wang and Shauna Yang Ryan, and you know, but now with Charles Yu and then Elaine Shea Chu and Lisa Shaw, like it just seems like or Kaiming Chang. What are your thoughts on all of this?
I love it. I love my Taiwanese people / Chinese diasporic people, because like you sort of alluded to this earlier, there's like sort of definitely a Venn diagram of us. So. Yeah, I love it. And I think we're all like writing different things and it's just amazing. I think, you know, I'm somebody who is very influenced by Asian American literature. Mm-hmm. I went to Berkeley undergrad and, you know, I studied with Elaine Kim and Sally Wong, who are really just the founders of the field when it comes to Asian American literature and Asian American studies. So, I mean, at that time, I didn't realize how like historic and iconic this was. I mean, I thought they were amazing, but I didn't know that, you know, like not everybody has that experience of studying with these like pioneers in the field. But I got such a wonderful education as an English major with like an Asian American bent when I was an undergrad. And actually, you know, the name, this is, Paula had a question in the chat because she was saying Fiona versus Ona. The name Ona is actually a tribute to Bone by Fei Ying, which is a novel that I love. And I read that in undergrad and was like, the top of my head was blown off because I had just never read a story that was so precise and moving. And like, it just really, really inspired me. So one of the characters in that book, her name is Ona. So I wanted to sort of have a little wink to that in my book.
Yeah, I get the feeling there are a lot of Easter eggs and winks in your book. So
And I feel like maybe I've even like forgotten what some of them were because it took me 5 years to write this book. But Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah. And then just a little bit more about Asian American literature. I was talking to Reese Kwan, and she said you guys went to the same high school.
We did. So we're both from Cerritos in Southern California, which is a suburb about 20 miles south of LA proper. And we went to Whitney High School. We didn't know each other. But yeah, it was like this really intense experience because Whitney is like a very academically rigorous magnet school. And I haven't actually talked to Reese about what her experience was, but I had a really difficult time because, you know, I wanted to like go out and meet guys and like smoke cigarettes and drink Crown Royal. So I don't know.
At a booking club.
Yeah. So, yeah.
But I think the fact that you both came from this high school, like you're opening the way for so many people's stories. I think that part is.
I don't know. I suspect that school produces a lot of like Asian American professionals, but you know, if somebody from Whitney High School wants to invite Reese and I to come back and give a talk about fiction writing, I think that would be freaking just amazing in like the assembly room.
Right? Just to say like, forget everything your parents might want you to do. There is another way. Mm-hmm. So, but granted, you know, and this is a question that I've thought about. So it was like a, you know, majority Asian, very academically inclined high school. But do you think, on the other hand, do you think growing up somewhere where Asian Americans were not a minority kind of shaped the way you view the world or the way you move through the world or the way your characters move through the world?
Yeah, I mean, I can talk about me personally. You know, when my family first came to the U.S., we lived in Missouri for a couple years. And that was a situation, because my dad was a professor. So he was like teaching at this small state college in Missouri. And, you know, we were sort of like one of the very few Asian families in the little town. And then to move from, and which was like a huge culture shock. Like, you know, I didn't speak English. I was like coming from Taipei in the third grade. And then to move from that situation to Southern California, which is like very ethnically diverse, lots of Asian Americans, lots of Central Americans. And, you know, just there's such a mix of different ethnicities in the area that I grew up in. So that was like a secondary culture shock because I was coming from Missouri. But growing up, I don't think I really had a sense of what was normal and what wasn't, and what a gift that was to not really feel like, oh, I was sort of this other thing because of my race and ethnicity. And so I wanted to sort of imbue that in my characters too. I don't name that, you know, they don't live in Cerritos. I think that I just leave it sort of vague that they live in Southern California.
Yeah.
But I wanted them to just also have the sense of life and belonging that I did. And it wasn't until I went to college and took a course in Asian American studies that I was really able to put my experience and the stories of my friends into the context of America, you know, like learning about the different ways of immigration or learning about all the various factors that created immigration of Asian Americans to the U.S. throughout the 19th and 20th century. So I feel very lucky to have both lived it and then to have learned about it in class and undergrad.
Right. The framework and the context for it. And then feeling then connected to something larger or...
Yeah, because I think even though in junior high and high school, I grew up around lots of Asian Americans, you know, the history that we were learning is sort of the compulsory American history that doesn't include people of color, doesn't include indigenous histories. So you know, when I got to undergrad and read like Howard Zinn, I think that was like a very eye-opening experience, because just because you grew up surrounded by other people of color doesn't mean you necessarily have this narrative of how you and your family belong. So I think it was really important for me to get that education.
Yeah. Or just even, I think Peter Rojo Davies has talked about this idea of broken lineages in Asian American stories, just that we are connected, but then sort of like, because of things like the Exclusion Act, or I don't know, the 1965 immigration, like things, there are these larger forces at work that are kind of shaping our stories, even as the characters, your characters sort of live their individual lives. So.
Yeah. And Asian Americans are so diverse. You know, it's sort of a cliche to say, you know, we're not a monolith and we need to disaggregate data for the various ethnicities that are contained within Asian America. But I also want to, you know, acknowledge that the term Asian American comes out of a political thrust in the 1960s when, you know, out of the movement for Black power and the struggle for ethnic studies, you know, Asian Americans felt like we needed a place to have that distinction as well. So I think that, you know, so many years later after the term Asian American was coined, we can hold all of that in truth. You know, it doesn't have to be one or the other.
Yeah. I mean, it's solidarity, not just within the community, but with other communities.
So yeah.
That's the power of it. But speaking of solidarity, we haven't talked about a character who's one of my favorites in the book, Juan. How did you sort of, you know, it is a story of female friendship, but then Juan, you know, is an important part of, you know, their teenhood and adulthood. And just if you could kind of talk about just how, you know, what it meant to have him be a presence, like a recurring character or presence in their sort of in their triad. So
he's a character who also grew up with Fiona and Jane. And, you know, as they're figuring out romantic prospects, sexuality, you know, individual identity, because I think one of the themes that pervades this book is Fiona and Jane trying to figure out where one person begins and the other one ends. And having Juan there as a witness, Ellie, you know, especially in the story that I read from, that's a moment when Jane is realizing that she doesn't have to always follow what Fiona is doing, just because Fiona is the leader, as it were, in their friendship. And Juan is Korean American and he is gay. And, you know, it was really interesting for me to write that character because I didn't plan it that way. It was just sort of as I was watching him and listening to the ways that he was being, I realized, oh, this character is queer. And I don't know. I feel like in my life, there's so many different identities that are always intersecting and all of them deserve space.
Yeah. It's, and that, again, that story, there's really interesting shifting sort of power dynamics throughout in terms of the friendship and yeah, I think you really, beautifully portrayed sort of the complications and all that, not only when they were teenagers, but just throughout their lives. Which does sort of beg the question, how did they do in the pandemic?
Well, Fiona is a mom, and I feel like parents in the pandemic had such a unique experience. I'm not a parent, but many of my close friends are parents of young kids, and you know, and as a single person and a child-free person, I, of course, had my own struggles. I was very lonely, moments where I was very depressed. And, you know, I would text one of my good friends who's a mom, and I would be like, God, you have it so good because you have your family, you know, you have a support network. And she was like, girl, please, I can't stand these people. I wish I was you, you know, having my own space. So the grass is always clean, the greener on the other side. Yeah, so there's a story in here actually where Fiona tells Jane that she's pregnant, and Jane is really happy and excited to be an auntie, but there's something sort of like dark underneath it where she feels like, oh, my best friend is going away again. I've lost her so many times to these various men in her life, but now I'm really going to lose her because she's going on planet motherhood. And I wonder if they were in the pandemic, if that would sort of be another split in their friendship, because it's just, at least in what I've observed, it's been so different and it's been difficult for every one of us. I feel like we're all just shells of our former selves at this point.
Yeah.
Sorry, that was like a very depressing answer.
No, but I mean, I think it speaks to just how powerfully attached your readers are to these characters, and that I want just only the best for both of them, but also we've also collectively just been through hell the last 2 years. So what do you, I just want to ask, like, before we open up to reader questions, like, what are you working on now? I seem to remember you had a 2-book deal, and so like you have another project.
Yeah, I'm working on my second book. My editor keeps asking me if I have pages to show her, and I keep trying to push her off. But I'm working on a second book, and it has a lot of historical research. So part of it is about the formation of Los Angeles Chinatown in the 19th century. Mm-hmm. I'm also trying to graduate from my PhD program. So my program has a creative component and a critical component. So Fiona and Jane is what I'm churning in for the creative project, but I'm in the middle of finishing up my critical inquiry. And I have to finish doing that in the next couple of months. So that's been very pressing. And I've been also trying to write like nonfiction essays here and there. I've also been trying to like get back into exercising after this like 2 years of not exercising in the pandemic. So yeah, it's just been a weird time.
Yeah. I am, for any, you know, people who are tuned in, I will recommend Jean's latest essay from the New York Times on her letter of recommendation to the subjunctive. It's
thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So that's what sort of inspired my question about sort of, even if you're not fully bilingual, let's say, I think, I don't know, traveling between worlds or between languages does make you think about tenses and shaping the way you view your characters and all that. If anyone has any questions they'd like to share, or
I think we're
feel supposed, free to put it in the chat.
Yeah, ask us questions. It can be about anything.
Yes.
I have a question for you. Like, what is the, is that a Keanu?
Yes.
Hello in the back. Is there a story behind that? Are you a big Keanu fan?
Well, so during the pandemic, I have two friends, Beth Wynn and Amy Fon, and we're part of the Asian American karaoke book club that I think you may have heard of, Jean. Mm-hmm. And anyway, as part of it, we got into this habit of like sending each other gifts in the mail. And so this is from Amy, and this is one round. And so this is Keanu. I won't kind of get up to show it now, but if you run your hand back and forth over the pillow, he disappears into behind a red curtain, or he appears. So yeah, but he's, I don't know. Do you remember Dave Chappelle's like racial draft? Like Asians, we claim Keanu.
Yes, we totally claim him. Have you seen the new Matrix?
Yes. It totally panders to our age.
Yes, I think so. Yeah. Cause that like changed like my world when I watched it. I think I must have been in college at that time. But
I mean, the sequel panders us to, because it changed, it rocked us then, it rocks us now, because it's like, basically young Gen Xers, geriatric millennials will save the world. So
I think so. Yeah. And you have to like leave your boring marriage and your kids in order to do it and like, you know, get back together with your former lover, which is anyway.
Who happens to be in canneries.
Yeah, right.
So we have some great questions. Joseph asks, why are Jane's chapters told in the first person while Fiona's are told in the third person? And I did also notice, to add to that, there seem to be more Jane chapters than Fiona chapters, POV chapters.
So. Sure. Yeah. And I like to point out that Joseph also said, say something, ... I'm not sure what that means. But thank you for that question, Joseph. So like I said earlier, I wrote The Movers, which was a Jane story in the first person. And then because as a writer, I tend to naturally gravitate toward the first person. I don't know if you have thoughts about this, Vanessa, but I feel like there's like people who love first person and then there's people who like abhor first person, and are just always writing in third person. So when I started writing this book, I was really not comfortable working in third person. I just felt like it was too powerful to like know everything that was going on. So I like to just stick in the mind of the first person. But as I was writing more and more of these stories, third person really actually allowed me to learn a lot more about Fiona's world, because you can sort of move around. That's just like a craft thing, really. You can like observe, you can be in her head like really directly. And so I don't know. I wish I had like a really smart answer to be like, I totally planned this all the way through. But it just sort of organically came out that way. And then I kept going. And I actually did write a story that was from Fiona's point of view. So the second story in the book, which is called The Inheritance, that used to be in the first person from Fiona's point of view. And then because of the structure of the book and the shape that the book was taking, I, you know, had to change it to third person. And I will also add that there's a couple of stories that I wrote that are like part of the universe of this book, but they didn't make it in the book because they're not about Fiona and Jane. They're about like Fiona's brother. There's a story about him. And I don't know. I sort of have this fantasy of continuing to work on those other stories and like release them as B-sides to the book.
That was actually going to ask. Like, what? Your fans are clamoring for the B-sides. We want more of this world. So.
Okay. I mean, I'll try to work on them after I finish my dissertation.
Yeah. So another question from Yuppie Puppy 07.
Amazing name.
What was it like to pitch this story? Oftentimes we are not seen. What helped to make Fiona and Jane's stories visible and taken seriously? Yeah, because it's about young women. It's about, you know, what do you think?
I guess this is a question about like, because I mean, my agents pitched the story to the editors, but like I had to query agents and pitch the story in the era before that. So maybe I can just talk about that part. I think that, you know, one of the challenges of being a writer is that I didn't really know how to talk about my book. Like I found it very awkward and embarrassing to talk about my book as a pitch. And then I actually had lots of help from my friends who were either like also querying agents or people who like already had agents and sort of like knew the ropes, and also like professors and mentors. So I like asked for help, and, you know, asking for help is also very awkward and embarrassing. Everything is very embarrassing, which is why, you know, I like to drink champagne. But to answer Yuppie Puppy 07, what was it like to pitch this story? Besides it being embarrassing, I think lots of writers will say this, but you have to just persevere. You have to just like get over yourself and really believe in your manuscript and these characters, no matter how much rejection you got, because there's so much rejection. And I don't know what helped to make Fiona and Jane visible. I guess I had published a couple of stories from the collection before I queried agents and, you know, before I had finished this manuscript. So, you know, that's like a very practical answer. Like if you're working on a novel, or if you're working like a long project or a story collection, you can sort of, you know, make strides by publishing parts of it. And maybe that's what helped. But honestly, there's so many different paths to publication. So that's just what I did.
Or maybe part of it is this world and milieu of your characters. It's all very familiar to you, but maybe you understood that this was like something still new to other people for whom this wasn't familiar. Like characters like this are in the world.
I didn't know that, Vanessa. I did not think that characters like these or stories like this were not visible in the world. I don't know. I think thinking about books that way, you know, like when I was still working on the manuscript, I had no idea of what it meant for my book to be like, to, you know, like one of the things that happens is that you have to have comps when you're trying to pitch the book. I had no idea what any of that was all about. So I didn't think that. I just loved these characters. I know that sounds very corny, but I just loved these characters so much. And I was just like, I believe in these women. And, you know, even if my book hadn't sold, I just wanted to give them the care and the attention that I believe they deserved.
Yeah. I mean, part of, as embarrassing, like coming up with a pitch is, it's a way of honoring the work, mm-hmm. giving it, the, you know, it, it's of introducing it to the world.
Yeah.
One more question. And then actually I have some speed round questions to close this
out. Oh my God. Okay.
So, after the B-side publication, are you contemplating a novel soon? Would you draw from one of these characters? So I think you partly answered it with like your sort of immediate next book project, but yeah, do you think you might revisit Fiona and Jane again?
I don't know. I don't know. Maybe. I feel like, you know, I'm sort of like in this massive cyclone of book publicity that it's very hard to see. Like I haven't like written anything. Like I'm sure you know this, Vanessa, because you've published books. But like when you're in this like publicity phase of things, you just have no time to write, because to write requires a lot of, you know, like quiet time.
Alone time.
Yeah, alone time. And so I actually haven't written anything, you know, for the last couple of months, because I've been like answering emails and like scheduling things, you know, which I'm very lucky to have an amazing team at Viking who helps me. But I haven't been able to think about like all the weird ideas that may proliferate when you just have a lot of alone time. So I am working on the second book, which is set in 19th century Los Angeles, about the first Chinese Americans to settle in Southern California. But beyond that, I really don't know. I'm open to so many things. Like I don't know what's gonna happen.
Well, we're excited to find out. So
Thank you.
So speed round. No right answers, no wrong answers.
Okay.
What comes to mind first? Mm-hmm. Okay. Sequins versus glitter.
Sequins, because glitter is too messy.
Yes. LA versus New York City.
Sorry, but I have to go with LA. Obviously, like I'm not even gonna explain it.
Yeah. 310 or the 213?
Well, 310 is the West Side, right?
Yeah.
And 213 is downtown. So I have to go with East Side. Yeah, I have to go with East Side 213.
Okay. Well, but even a deeper cut, 213 versus the 626.
626 for sure.
Yeah.
People, if you know, you know. I'm all about the 626.
Okay. The 405 versus the 10.
I have to say the 10 because the 10 traverses the entire, like, you know, it's like an east-west freeway and you see so much of the city. The 405 sucks. Where does the 405 even go to? Like, I don't know.
It goes into a traffic jam.
It goes to San Diego, right? Yeah.
San Diego. It goes behind the orange curtain. Okay. Panda cookies versus Pocky sticks.
Oh my God. I guess, this is really hard. I love them both. I can't decide. I guess
You can pass if you want.
Okay, pass. Okay. This is too hard.
White Rabbit versus Hoff Lakes.
Oh my God, this is so hard too. I love Hoff Lakes, I have to say. Yeah, I'm going to go with Hoff Lakes. They're such a classic.
Okay, and last one. Thank you for humoring me. Jumbo's Clown Room or The Lusty Lady?
I don't even know what The Lusty Lady, is that an SF?
Yes, it was a co-op.
Okay. I'm not familiar. I mean, I love Jumbo's Clown Room. That's like very close to where I live and I support the dancers there. I've had so many wonderful nights in the warm embrace of Jumbo's Clown Room. I have to go with Jumbo's.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Jean.
Thank you, Vanessa. This is so much fun.
Well, thank you to both of you. And thank you for that interesting lightning round. You really have a thing for highways. There's like three or four questions about highways. It was confusing.
It's Southern California.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I get it. And Jean, since you are the first author I've hosted that unabashedly has pulled out the bubbly, I decided to,
cheers, Paula.
And I was only going to do it for show, but I found myself listening to the two of you and inviting.
Well, here's the book passage.
Yes. We are so honored to have you. And we always love bringing Vanessa into the picture and look forward to your release, your new book coming up in the spring. But for now, Jean, please, congratulations and continued success. And I hope you get in some in-person touring along with the being safe and virtual. But we really appreciate you both coming. For our audience, thank you for participating with your great questions, as well as just your good energy and watching. And we know you're going to support this book and this event by buying the book from Book Passage. We do have signed first editions. Thank you so much for getting those book plates to us, Jean. We really appreciate it. And you can feel free to order online, order over the phone with a bookseller, or come into our San Francisco and our Corte Madera stores very safely. Until next time, you two wonderful writers, thank you.
Thank you so much for having me.
And cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers, Jean, Fiona and Jane.